Good morning, students. Yesterday we have studied about deadlock, what is a deadlock, and the resource allocation graph. I am repeating the definition of deadlock again, that deadlock is a situation in which the process are held and not able to perform their task as the required resources are held with the other process. So today's our topic is characterization of deadlock. Basically, there are four conditions of deadlock. Number one, mutual exclusion. Number two, hold and wait. Number three, no preemption. Number four, circular wait. For a deadlock to occur, all the four conditions should be present, then only we can say that there is a deadlock in the system. These conditions are also called the Kaufman condition. So we'll start with the first, that is mutual exclusion. Mutual exclusion means that there should be a resource that can only be held by one process at a time, and no other process can access or use that particular resource. That means the resource which the resource is being not shared between the process at the same time. If the printer is an example of that resource which cannot be shared by the process simultaneously, so in mutual exclusion, that only one process can share a resource at a time. So this diagram, we will see that process resource R1 is allocated to process P1. That means the process P1 can only share this resource at a time. Whether that particular process is using a resource or not, it is being allocated to it, so it is used by one process at a time. This is the problem of mutual exclusion. We'll see here. There must exist at least one resource in the system which can be used by only one process at a time. If there is no such resources, then deadlock will never occur. Okay, this condition is also there. And printer is the best example of a resource that can be used by only one process at a time. So this is the condition of mutual exclusion. Next we have hold and wait condition. Hold and wait condition means a process can hold multiple resources and still request for more resource from other process which are hold them. You see this in the diagram. See here, we have two process, P1 and P2. P2 is currently holding resource R2 and resource R3 and requesting for the resource R1 for completing its execution, and R1 is allocated to process P1. So this is the condition of hold and wait here, that process P2 is holding resource R2 and R3 and waiting for resource R1 so that it can complete its execution. This is the condition of hold and wait. There must exist a process which holds some resource and waits for another resource held by some other process. See here, the process P2 is holding R2 and R3 waiting for R1, but R1 is allocated to P1. P1 will not release R1 unless and until it completes its execution. Okay, so the process P2 will not be able to complete its execution as R1 is held by the P1 process P1. So this condition is known as hold and wait condition, holding a resource and waiting for the another resource. This is hold and wait. Next condition we have is no preemption. As we have studied about as we all know the meaning of preemption and non-preemption, as we have studied in CPU scheduling, like what is meaning by preemptive, non-preemptive. So here the no preemption. No preemption means you cannot take a process, you cannot take a resource from a process unless and until the process will voluntarily release that resource. Okay, we cannot snatch a particular resource from the process. A resource cannot be preempted from a process by force. A process can only release a resource voluntarily. Voluntarily means when the process completes its execution, then only it will release that resource, unless and until no. Once the resource has been allocated to a process, it cannot be preempted. If we allocate a resource to a process, that process, until it finish its execution, it will not preempt or release that particular resource. So it means that we cannot snatch forcefully from one process and give it to another process. For example, suppose process P1 and P2 are here. P1 is requesting for resource R1 and it is holding resource R2. Now, whether process P1 is using resource R2 or not, we cannot preempt or snatch the resource R2 from it unless and until P1 voluntarily releases it. As we can see in this diagram, that process P2 require both R1 and R2 for completing its execution. So it requests for resource R2, but resource R2 is allocated to P1. When P1 will release R2, then only P2 will complete its execution. So we cannot snatch forcefully the resource from the process unless and until it will release it voluntarily. So this is the condition of no preemption, that we cannot take a process. We cannot take a resource from a process. It will only release it after it completes its execution. Okay. So this is the condition of no preemption. And the fourth condition is circular wait. Circular wait is a process is waiting for a resource held by the second process, which is waiting for the resource held by the third process, and so on, till the last process is waiting for a resource held by the first process. This will form a circular chain. We'll see this by at this diagram. See here. Process P1 is requesting for resource R1. Resource R1 is allocated to P2. Okay. P2 is requesting for R2. R2 is allocated to P3, and P3 is requesting for R3. This forms a complete chain or complete cycle. So this is called as circular wait, which we'll see here in this line. Till the last process is waiting for the resource held by the first process, and this will form a circular chain. All the process must wait for the resource in a cyclic manner, where the last process wait for the resource held by the first process. We'll see this, where the last process wait for the resource held by the first process. So this is the condition of circular wait. In this, they form a cycle where waiting for the resource is done. So this is circular wait. For a deadlock to occur, all these four conditions, that is mutual exclusion, hold and wait, no preemption, and circular wait, all these four conditions must occur, then only we can say that the process or the system is in deadlock condition. If we will be able to any of these four conditions, if we deny or we can say this condition does not occur, or we will stop this condition by occurring, then we can save our system from deadlock. But for a deadlock to occur, all these four conditions should be there. So we will just revise it again what we have studied. First, mutual exclusion. First condition is mutual. Just remember one thing, students. You should also know that these conditions are called Kaufman condition. Sometimes the question comes in the exam that define Kaufman conditions. So don't get confused. Characterization of deadlock, necessary conditions of deadlock, and Kaufman condition all are the same. First mutual exclusion. Mutual exclusion means no sharing of resources at the same time. Best example is printer. Only one process will use a resource at a time. Number two, hold and wait. That means holding a resource or multiple resources and waiting for another resource which is held by the another process. See this diagram. Holding multiple resource and waiting for the another resource which is held by the other process. This is called hold and wait condition. Next key, no preemption. That is, you cannot take a resource from the process voluntarily unless it completes its execution. Then only that process will release that resource. And last is circular wait. That is, the process wait for the resource in a circular form and they form a circular chain. See this diagram. This process P1, P2 and P3, resource R1, R2 and R3, the waiting and allocated in such a way that they form a circular chain. This is called circular wait. So this is all for today's lecture. We'll see how to prevent this condition in the next class. If you have any query and doubt, then please comment in the comment window, and you can also WhatsApp me or message me personally. All right, thank you.